Yes.
Who, I mean, a few people have been there. Meyerowitz.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Provost. Thank you all for coming. It's really an astonishing audience to see on a wet night like tonight. And I've been told by numerous faculty that this is a very mixed interdisciplinary group of architects and artists, photographers, political science, and other disciplines, which is very exciting. I've never had a chance to meet with an audience, to share this experience, and have it sort of stirred up in a broth of intellectual discipline, such as is possible here tonight. And so I'd like to offer this as a conversation. Let's not it be just a one-sided lecture. If you have questions as we go, please ask as we go. We'll have a question and answer period afterwards, but I'd like to have a dialogue with you since this is the only time we'll have to spend together. You stole my thunder here by telling the whole story, but I will share with you my awakening about this because I think it's very important for all of us to understand that we do have a role in our time and our culture and in our society, that we're not always meant to be on the fringes as observers, that there are times when it's okay to be a participant, even if it goes against the restrictions that are placed upon one. And I found myself in such a position a few days after Ground Zero, after the attacks on Ground Zero. Probably like all of you, the emotion after those buildings were attacked and fell was such that you may have felt you wished you could do something, you could help in some way. And yet there was a kind of paralysis, whether it was distance too far or whether it was the fact that you couldn't enter the site in Manhattan. It had been cordoned off almost immediately. And so as a native New Yorker, I was stuck with those feelings of wanting to do something and being unable to make a commitment or to be of any assistance whatsoever. I also was not in New York City when it happened. I was 300 miles away, but they closed New York City immediately, and one couldn't enter or leave New York for 4 or 5 days. So on the fifth day, I returned to New York, and the first thing I did was to go down to the area around Ground Zero because I lived about a mile away. And those buildings, I'd watched the buildings be built. I had spent years, you know, cycling around Lower Manhattan and walking that part of it. I knew it well. I went down and I had one of those epiphanies that changes your life. You never know when this is going to happen. And I think it's a good thing to stay open to because sometimes you're being given a direction. You meet your teacher on the path and you don't know that it's the moment until your consciousness comes into play. And on that afternoon, I stood 5 blocks north of the North Tower on Greenwich and Chambers Street, for those of you who might know that area of New York. And I was in a crowd of people. I always carry a Leica camera on my shoulder. Not tonight, but tonight I have 2 microphones here. And I stood in the crowd, and I just raised my camera to my eye so that I could sort of get a feel for what things looked like. There was no picture to be made. I was too far away. As I raised my camera, from behind, a woman police officer punched me on my shoulder like that and said, "Hey, buddy, no photographs. This is a crime scene." Well, as any good New Yorker gets in their birthright, it says, "Do not hesitate to argue with authority." "And what are you talking about?" I said, "I'm standing here on a public thoroughfare. The crime scene is in there. I could raise my camera if I want." And her response was, "I'm taking that camera away from you, buddy, if you do that." I said, "Wait a second, suppose I was the press, what would you do then?" And she said, "Oh, the press, huh?" And she did this incredible, imperious gesture. And behind her, behind me, was the press corps. Perhaps a dozen or more people with big TV video cameras and film cameras, all tied up with police tape. And they had just been cordoned off. And I asked her, when are they going to go in? And she said, I told you, never, no photography allowed. I walked away from this encounter with her, steaming, mad, that they had dared to take history off limits in some way. And I thought, they can't do this. There has to be a way to make some photographs. And suddenly I realized that's what I could do. I couldn't move steel. There was no reason to give blood anymore. I had given money and would continue to give money. But the way to be functional and useful was to try to go in there and make a body of work that would describe the impact on Lower Manhattan and be useful as a historical document. I had never made an archive before, but I had written a history book called Bystander, The History of Street Photography, and I had spent years in archives all over America and Europe. And I had looked at hundreds of archives, from historical ones to photographic ones to records of building bridges and tunnels and roads, and I had a sense of what an archive might be constituted of and how to raise the level of it, so I thought. I approached a director at the Museum of the City of New York and said, you write me a letter that will help me to get in and I'll give you an archive. I shouldn't have said give. Always think about who you're giving something to see if they could be the right parent for the offering you're giving them. This museum was broke. The director soon left. I had offered it to basically the wrong institution. But he did write a letter. I did try to get in with this letter, which didn't work. Show a letter to a cop doesn't necessarily mean that he's going to read it. Anyway, I finally was able to make contact with a friend of mine in the Parks Department. And he was the commissioner of Manhattan's parks, and he gave me a worker's pass. So by parlaying the pass and the letter, I was able to confuse or convince cops at different places, depending upon how sleepy they were, how bored they were, that I was doing something useful. Of course, I appealed to Mayor Giuliani at the same time to allow me to create a team of six photographers, three younger photographers and three older photographers, a cinematographer and an oral historian, thinking that it would take six or eight of us to actually save the entirety of this site on film and on record in a way that would be truly a useful document in the future. But Giuliani had more important things to do, and so history was sort of brushed aside. So I took it in my own hands to do this, and it was an astonishing adventure. I learned a lot about myself, the immense spirituality of the site changed me, and I basically lived with 1,000 men and women for 8 months who committed themselves completely to doing this healing of a large wound in our national psyche and in the physical properties of Manhattan. And I think I made a body of work that will be useful. Some of the issues that I dealt with, I'd like to talk about as we go, and maybe you will feel that there are some appropriate questions to ask me about the ongoing process, because if you go in as an artist, is what you do making art, or is making a document and a record something that is not about art? There are balances and questions that come up that I think are important ones, and I'm happy to engage these questions with you all. So let me begin by taking you on a little tour around the site. We have the lights, please. First, let me say that before I did this work, I was planning an exhibition called Looking South, Landscapes of Lower Manhattan. For 15 years, I had a studio in the Chelsea area, the photo district of New York City, and that was my view out my studio window. And over the years, I made large 8x10 format photographs of the changing weather patterns in lower Manhattan. And of course, in the skyline was always the World Trade Center. And my subject certainly wasn't the World Trade Center itself. It was kind of the big sky country of lower Manhattan. I was scheduled to have this exhibition in October of 2001. And I had been printing these pictures all summer and living with them in my studio on Cape Cod. Great big 10-foot prints of the World Trade Center surrounded by it. So when the buildings were attacked, in a way, the world that I was living with physically crumbled right in front of me. This is the south, the remains of the South Tower. And the little lump of a building at the foot of it was a 24-story hotel, the Vista International Hotel, sitting at the foot of the 110-story tower. And you could see it's just festooned with steel. This is inside the North Tower. This is the north wall over here of the North Tower. And that fragment in the center, in front of the Woolworth Building, which was once the tallest structure in New York City, that fragment is about 14 stories tall. And it goes 7 stories below ground. And this became the iconic image of Ground Zero. The thing that was most awesome upon entering the site was to see the materiality of it. These buildings collapsed, and down came steel and cabling and plumbing and wiring and aluminum and everything metallic. All of the concrete that the floors had been made out of was pulverized when the floors pancaked one on top of each other. And that huge smoke plume that you saw in all the photographs was the concrete being pulverized. So when it fell, it was just steel. And to stand in front of this twisted mass on a daily basis is to feel one's own fleshy vulnerability. You began to feel the sense of how fragile and insignificant you are, and how you couldn't withstand, you know, that kind of fall. And it's one of the reasons that so few remains were recovered, because people were shattered and just shredded. And a horrifying thing to think about. But when you stand against that steel, you have a kind of connection to it, a visceral connection to it. It's a profound connection. These are two photographs joined together so that one could have a sense of the scale of the site. I'm standing on a building similar to this one. It was a matched pair of buildings on the 9th floor. Most of the time, I used an old-fashioned wooden view camera with sheet film because I wanted to try to create a body of work that would allow the viewer to have the experience itself rather than to have an experience of looking at, quote, a work of art. I wanted it to be something you felt in your gut, rather than something you just could look at and say, oh yeah, this is, I see there's a building here and there's rubble here. And my intention was to make these prints enormous sizes. And in fact, when we had the exhibition, they were generally in the 10-foot range, with some of them being as big. This picture was 22 feet across and about 12 feet high. so that one could stand there almost as if you were standing at the site itself. Since I was privileged to be inside, I wanted, in a way, to share that experience with everyone else who had been locked out of the site. Now I'll take you on a little walk around to see some of the structures that were wounded at this point. This is the American Express building in the World Financial Center, and sticking in the side of it is one of the modules that the World Trade Center was built out of. These modules were three stories high, and they were sort of a trident of steel welded together. And this one must have been snapped out the way you would flick a matchstick off your finger, out of the South Tower. And it hurled itself probably 150 yards through the air and stabbed itself into the side of the building. And this is inside the Winter Garden, which is a big open atrium-like space between the two buildings of the World Financial Center. This was a great glassed-in structure with palm trees planted inside. And I don't think there were maybe only one or two palm trees left standing by the time everything fell. This is a pair of seven-story buildings that fronted the plaza that led to the World Trade Center. And you can see this one has been sheared almost in half. And at one point, I was able to go up on top of this building, and I found three airplane seats sitting on top of the building. I have to tell you, to come across something as familiar as that sitting outside was horrifying, to say the least. This is a building that is called the Deutsche Bank building, which they're now going to tear down. In the zone, it was known as the Godzilla building because it looked like Godzilla had scraped down the front of it. But it took the brunt of steel flying off of the South Tower fell right into this building, which faced the tower itself. They thought for a while, architects would be interested in this, I think, they thought for a while that they could salvage this building, but they didn't cover it up in time, and mold grew in the building, and it so infested the building that now it has to come down. Oddly enough, during the 8 months I was down at the site, things would happen with this building. Wind would come across the top and go down the elevator shafts, and it would blow things out of the building. So sometimes you'd see paper, streams of paper coming off desks like flights of pigeons out of the building, you know. Or other times windows would be just popped out and go whistling into the site. It's quite scary to work near that building. So this is the plaza, which has dropped a story and a half onto the malls that were below it. And what you see here are rescue teams. This is only about 10 days or so after the buildings fell. There were rescue teams still searching through the rubble. And many of these teams were canine teams. And a strange thing happened sort of a little sidebar to it. The dogs began to refuse to go into the site because they never found anybody that they could rescue. And they started getting, as the trainers said, neurotic about their failure. And so when they were led into the site, they would start to whine and squeal and turn away and put their tail between their legs. They didn't want to go in and fail again. So it's an interesting psychological thing. They had to try to sort of retrain these dogs to be useful again. There's also another sort of strange story. Most of the people who were down on the site there would crawl into the little voids and crevices that the fallen steel had left to see if they could find remains. And they would crawl in on elbows and knees as far as they could go, and they had to feel their way to see if people, if they could find things. And they said the only way we could do it was to take whatever we found and to smell it to see if it was food or decomposing bodies or whatever other matter. And that's one of those things you don't know. It's a little known fact, but it's the way that people had to behave. They had to kind of eat that experience daily. Think about that. One day, on the day that this picture occurred, which was right around now, it was October 8th or 9th or something like that, and I had been photographing about 100 yards away, and two policemen came over to me and said, "You have to leave right now." I said, "Well, wait a second, guys, here's my badge, and you know, I'm photographing, I'm making this project." They said, "It doesn't matter, Chief Fellini wants you out of here now." I said, "Come on, let me talk to Chief Fellini. I'll explain to him what I'm doing," thinking I could be reasonable. So they said, no, he doesn't want to talk to you. He just wants you to go. I said, "Come on, I'm making something important here. This is going to be for history, for your grandchildren." He said, "Yeah, listen, fella, just get out of here now." So I said, "Okay, could I go that way? And my car is over there." Of course, it wasn't. So I came over to this point, and suddenly I see this, and I feel the sun on my shoulders, and it feels like an interesting place. And I set up my camera, and I'm starting to make a picture, and a couple of firemen drive up, and they say, "Hey, what are you doing?" And I said, I'm photographing." I said, but you can't photograph here." I said, "Well, I was just over with Chief Fellini." I said, "Oh, no problem. Okay, it's fine with me." But wow, now I know. So every day from then on, I would ask, "Who's the chief on duty today?" And I would get the name, and I would just drop it wherever I went, because in order to stay alive in the war zone, you've got to figure out some kind of strategy to staying in there. Because it happened so regularly that I was asked to leave that I don't know what made me persist. I mean, I just felt that it couldn't go unrecorded. This also had, I think, an early question for me. I remember at the moment I started to make the picture, and I felt the sun on my back. It felt so, it was one of those crystalline October days where it just feels good to be alive. And I felt that sensation, and then I caught myself thinking, "Oh, I have no right to feel this way. They're all dead in there, and I'm out here making photographs. I have no right." And I was struggling with myself and thinking that I must do this, that in fact, nature is indifferent to our craziness on Earth, and that beautiful things, I mean, beautiful days occur and horrible things happen on those beautiful days, and that in fact, photography, recording moments like this will help perhaps put it back in perspective as time goes on, things diminish in some way. And it felt important to me to be able to stand up as a photographer and say yes to this, that it's okay to make a photograph when you feel good about something, that one can't put on a tragic mask to photograph all the time. One has to photograph out of joy as well. I think part of the unsung heroics, if you will, of Ground Zero were the iron workers. These guys, and there were unknown hundreds of them, these guys literally took the entire thing apart. They cut every piece of steel that you see twisted together there. They climbed up on it. They put these heavy cables around it. They yanked it out. They welded it apart. They carted it away. And many of these guys, this guy in particular, were there for the building of the World Trade Center in the 70s, 60s and 70s. Guys who said to me, who would have thought that I'd come back and take down something that I, you know, I was part of. There were also many Native Americans who work as high steel workers on the site who came back. And in fact, they have their own flag. I may even have a picture of it here. They have the American flag with an Indian head in the middle. And they raise it on every site that they work on. They put up their flag. I think it also gives you a sense of the scale of things. You could get a sense of the dimension of the beams that were just lying around and the size of the pile. And that smoke, you see, the smoke continued well into February. And there were places in the pile where the temperature was 2,000 degrees. Boots melted right out from under you. The fuel from the jets had, for the fuel that didn't burn, that sloshed out of the tanks and went down the elevator shafts, fell to the bottom of the World Trade Center, and then the buildings fell on top of it. And that fuel was just burning whatever it could feed itself on. And so every time some steel was removed from the pile, oxygen would go in and it would enrich the fires down below. So it kept on burning and smoking and stinking for all those months. We're inside the South Tower here, and it was about 10 o'clock at night, and I saw groups of firemen running up over this pile. You have to remember, it's all sharp, knife-edge steel everywhere, and I saw these 30 to 40 guys running up in there, and I followed them up, and inside, in the center, there was a stairwell that had been uncovered, and in the stairwell, they found five firemen, the remains of five firemen in their great coats and everything, all their equipment intact. And so they were bringing them out. And when I got to this point and made the picture, then I went down closer, one of the firemen who came out of the stairwell said, this stairway is from the North Tower. And there was a sudden recoil, as if everybody got this jolt, that suddenly they realized that the stairway had flown more than 100 yards when the building fell and landed inside this pile and was buried in here. And they could, I have a sense, imagine these men in the stairwell flying through the air to their death. I think that's part of the bonding that took place down there, is that every time little revelations like that occurred, people would, they couldn't distance themselves from it. They felt it. They saw it. Their experience joined with it in some way. This was something that happened to all of us. The nation was joined together in mourning. You know, the world had come, in a sense, to be part of us, and that's changed now. All the goodwill that came our way has been dissipated by the policies that have been enacted since then. I had the funny feeling when I made this, for any of you who have ever seen photographs of the Civil War, and you see the guy sitting around in front of the tent, you know, looking exhausted and everything, the handlebar mustaches and the like. This was part of the scene on a daily basis around the site, these little rest areas where firemen or policemen would come out of working on their hands and knees. You notice they all have knee pads. Everybody's on their hands and knees scraping away. They would come to rest, but all around the site were thousands of chairs. Chairs like the ones you're sitting on, hotel lobby chairs, executive chairs, cafeteria chairs, Eames chairs, I mean, good and bad. And they had come out of the buildings and were arranged around the site like a bleachers. And they were constantly filled with thousands of workers who would take a break and they would sit there watching this spectacle of Ground Zero, because it was like nothing you could possibly imagine. It's the biggest stage set there was. The guy in the middle was not happy that I made the picture. You know, they were very protective, but I felt, tough luck, buddy. It has to be done, and I'm going to have a face-off with you here. And that's just the way it is, you know. Otherwise, I would have been intimidated by everybody, and work wouldn't have been made. But over time, most of these guys became more understanding and more supportive, and took me places. It was part of the connection that was forged during that time. There were also scenes of incredible poignancy. This is a group of firemen and a chaplain, and they formed a little prayer circle, a spontaneous prayer circle. And this wasn't the only time. I saw this countless times. Somebody would come out of the site and they would be so bereft by something they had seen or some experience will have brought them to their knees, and they couldn't go any further. And you would suddenly see a cluster of men come running over to this person to sort of bring them up, and a chaplain would arrive and they would have a little huddle, or they would pray, or they would just have a little cheer, something to sort of restore the well-being and to keep the community functioning. And to see that, to be, I mean, I was the walker on the site, you know. I just traveled around it over and over again, watching to see what was going on. And to come across that was so moving to me, and it gave me a sense of the richness of the spirituality of this site, how we all have this kind of interconnectedness, and that there are moments when tragedy strikes or there's a natural disaster, and we come together as community. And so to see it in little odd moments like this was incredibly restorative. It's hard to see, but in here, there's just a figure. It was just after dusk, and a few of us, you can see from the shadows, were standing around, and suddenly we hear somebody is playing taps in this huge amphitheater, which had gone quiet for a while, a change of shift at about that hour. This guy, a Broadway musician, went down. He begged some policeman to bring him in so that he could play taps for the dead. It was his offering. And some cop, instead of saying no, just had a moment of sensitivity, and he brought him in, and this guy played for that space. And I tell you, there were more than just the shadows of those four or five of us there, and we were all in tears. Just, I mean, spontaneously cried. That's when film would have been a really wonderful instrument to have. Each of the red flags generally signified that there was remains had been found there. And what they did on the site was a global positioning team came, and anytime remains were found, they would mark the spot and tag the remains with the marker, so that when forensics or DNA sampling sometime in the future identified that person, they would be able to say, that person was found or died at this spot, so that everybody would have a location. I mean, an incredibly sensitive and thoughtful thing to do for the families that remain. I guess what's not known, because one doesn't see pictures of it, but humble things fell also on that day. And in the strangest ways. I mean, there were hundreds and hundreds of trees in that little zone. Very few of them remain. They were lopped off. So what lopped them off like that? Something in that dust cloud was blowing, pieces of steel the size of cars. Things were hurtling around and scything down trees and lampposts and subway kiosks and parking meters. Things were just decapitated everywhere you went. And there was one block, just a few blocks north of this. I turned the corner, and all the parking meters on the block were like this. All of them were bent over in exactly the same way, and all of them had their glass faces. Well, they could be plastic also, but all of the faces had melted out of the parking meters. I asked myself, what? What was it like in that zone? What kind of heat, what kind of wind blew through that street to knock over all these parking meters? Usually it takes a truck backing into one to knock it over. But there they all were in this chorus line, bent over and having their faces dripping out. And that's something that we don't even think about, you know, but it's part of the record will show that, and it will allow anybody who reads the record to puzzle over what was the environment at that moment. What must it have been like? You could see how many windows on nearby buildings were taken out by the concussion and flying steel. There was a Memorial Day in November where they closed Church Street, and they made a huge open church out of it. And they invited all the family members to come. 7,000 family members came. And they used concrete barriers to block off the site itself so no one would enter the site and get hurt. After the ceremony, people started to leave, and there were half a dozen firemen on the other side of the barricade. And people started going to the firemen and giving them photographs and flowers and memorabilia to put somewhere on the site. And so this makeshift memorial arose. And I was walking with the firemen. I was on the other side of the barrier, and I was walking with them. And they were so incredibly tender. There wasn't one thing they did that was thoughtless. I mean, they would take the picture that you handed them, and they would look at the picture and then look back at the person who gave the picture, so that this contact, this connection was made. And then they carried it at this kind of dirge speed over to the pile and nestled it there. I tell you, I have never seen such gentleness. And they did it again and again and again. And on one of the trips back with these guys, two men beckoned to me to come. And so I went over thinking they were going to ask me a question. And it was a rabbi and a priest. Sounds like the beginning of a joke. And they called me over and they said, could you put this on the pile? And I said, I'll get one of the firemen. And they said, no, you put it on the pile. And I tell you, I lost it in a split second, because I went from being the observer watching it all happen, to suddenly being a participant in this act of, you know, a devotional act in a way. And I cried all the way over to that little pile, all of 50 or 60 feet. And I realized these guys were having to do that over and over again. It must have been so wrenching for them. During August, I had an exhibition of this work in Cape Cod, in Provincetown. And one morning, I received a phone call from a woman who called and said, "I just saw your show. I drove all the way across Massachusetts to see your show." And she said, "My daughter was on the first airplane to hit." And she said, "And when I was in the show, I looked and my daughter's picture is right there. He's just placed my daughter's picture. You photographed my daughter's photograph." And she said, "If you go to your exhibit, you'll see behind the photograph, I put her picture and my name and address." So I ran down to the museum, and there was, behind the photograph, was a photograph of the young woman and a little poem about her death. And so I scanned it and made a little print of it, and I put it up temporarily in the exhibition so that people could see this connection that happened. I have to honor these men, because if it wasn't for these men, truly, I would not have made this body of work. Early on, when I was being thrown out regularly, I literally bumped into these men one night. This is the Arson and Explosion Squad. They're all detectives. And that evening, they asked me what I was doing, and instead of throwing me out, when I explained to them what I was doing, they said, "Oh yeah, that's absolutely necessary. We're gonna protect you." And even though Giuliani says no, and our commissioner says no, you shouldn't be here, we're going to protect you because we think it should be done. So here's our cell phone numbers. Anytime you get stopped at any one of the entry points, you call us and we'll come and get you. And for the next 50 days, these guys protected me every single day. They would come in a little vehicle and pick me up and take me places, and anybody who dared to stop me, they would scream at. And on their last day, when they were leaving the site, they had their boss, who was the first deputy police commissioner, come down to the site. He took me to police headquarters, where he had me photographed and thumbprinted and barcoded, and he made up a little pass for me with my picture on it, an NYPD pass. I have it here because I get on the airplane with it. And it says, "Mayoral Photographer." Some old hunchback Irishman who was working there, when the woman said, "Well, what do we call him?" He said, "I call him the Mayoral Photographer." It was a hell of a name. And I wasn't going to say no, but no mayor knew. And from that day on, they weren't there. But I had this pass pinned to my chest. I would walk in and people would say, "Right this way." So I was free, finally. So it's to the men of the Arson and Explosion Squad, who I still stay in touch with quite regularly. An iron worker, he's got a bandage on his face because a few hours before he was using his torch to burn some of the standing rebar, and he touched some buried ammunition in a shooting range in the customs building, and it exploded, and he had a little piece of shrapnel in his cheek and had 6 or 8 stitches in his face. Came right back to work. This is a guy named Eddie. He talked from somewhere deeper than I could go. He always talked like this. And he had just gotten out of prison, And somehow he managed to get a job. How do you figure? He had some family connections, he said to me. I asked him, what'd you go to prison for? He said, I was in the insurance protection business. Anyway, I made this picture of him, and this picture ran in the New Yorker. And this guy bought up all the New Yorkers that he could find. And the next time I saw him, he came to me, and he was in love with me. Suddenly he said, oh, I'm a made man, Joel. Everybody in my neighborhood loves me now. Even my mother loves me now. Then he made me an offer. He said, listen, anything I can do for you. He said, I do slice and dice. He said, you know, your old lady, you want to get rid of her? He said, I make a little thing with some lime. You put the roses there. He said, I'll take care of it for you. Don't worry. I haven't taken him up on the offer yet, but it's nice to know there's an offer like that. Outstanding. See, photography is some use after all. One day, when the site was already below grade level, I was down in the site when one of the machines reached into a pile, and when it pulled out the stuff of the pile, suddenly thousands of photographs were fluttering in the air. And I picked some up, and it said, Archive of the Port Authority. It was their library. So I ran up the hill, and I found this guy, Ryan, who was the superintendent of the Port Authority Police. And I explained to him what was going on. He stopped the work. They all went down, and they cleaned out and saved as many of these photographs as they could. A few hours later, we catch up with each other, and he says, hey, Joel, look at this. And he shows me he found his graduation picture from the police academy. I mean, of all things to find. It's the needle in the haystack. Ryan. They were known as room service girls, you should excuse me. There were volunteers who wheeled these carts all around the site. There must have been hundreds of young men and women who brought hot drinks, cold drinks, sandwiches, candy bars, things like that, keeping everybody well nourished. It may look like the Keystone Cops to you, but they're holding $11 million in cash. They found the Bank of America vault, which had been on the, I think, eighth or ninth floor of the North Tower, and now it was three stories underground. And in it were $11 million in lira and pounds and yen and dollars, et cetera, et cetera. And they were lying, literally, everybody was lying down in the rubble, reaching into the vault and pulling out money and stuffing it in bags. And everybody smoked a big stogie. It was sort of the marker down in the site. They must have found a cache of cigars someplace, and everybody had a cigar all the time. And so they posed for this picture, and then they put all this money on a little cart, and they drove it away. And I happened to be down on the road when they drove it away, and one of the bags of money fell off. Now, as I think I mentioned, this was a relatively unfunded work that I was doing, and suddenly I saw my funding right in front of me. But instead, I was a good citizen and called them to a stop, and they loaded it back on the wagon. I think the most familiar sight after all of it was done was images of men and women on their hands and knees with garden rakes, hand trowels, just sifting, digging and sifting, looking for knuckle bones or rings or teeth or jaw bones, whatever they could find that might have withstood the force of the fall. And it went till the very end. Here is maybe a hip bone, just found and dropped on a cinder block so that somebody would come over and identify it and take it away. I didn't photograph remains. I felt that wasn't my job. There were forensic photographers who photographed these things in the morgue, and it didn't need me to do that. I mean, this is one of the few instances in which something was found, and it just happened to be like that. It happened, and I thought it was the right thing to do, but I felt that there was so much sensitivity around the remains, especially on the part of the firemen, that it was in my best interest to let that part go and just cover everything else. I mean, this is in February, and it's still smoking like that, and we're already, you know, a layer or so below grade level. And it was an extraordinary moment, too, because every time they pulled out one of the sticks, as they called the beams, this oxygen, as I mentioned, would rush in, and these plumes of smoke would explode into the air, and ash would rain down all over the site. Every day, I was covered in ash. My cameras, myself, just layered in ash. But the cloud rose up on that moment, and somehow it just sort of intercepted the light, and light glancing off the edge of the building came through it in this way, and it was a kind of spectacle in just a split second, and then it was gone. All the buildings were clad in this sheathing to prevent flying glass, because after the first few nights, when glass was, you know, whistling out of the buildings like that, they decided they had to do it, and they chose red. How about that? Made it pretty interesting to see. So the welders were suspended by cranes in baskets, and they were dropped onto these remaining towers, and they would burn them down bit by bit. They just took them apart. And all of this stuff is saved in a hangar at the JFK airport in New York. They're going to reassemble something, or they've given them to museums and places like that. I myself was able to take a 4,000-pound, 22-foot beam. It's not sitting in my living room. I took it to Venice, Italy, where I represented the U.S. Pavilion in the Venice Biennale for Architecture 2 years ago. And I decided that if I could get one of these pieces and bring it over there and plop it down in front of the building for all the architects to see what happens when a piece of the real thing is thrown out of itself, and you see it now in relation to ordinary life, it would be an important addition to the Biennale. And it turned out to be so. And afterwards, we couldn't figure out how to get it home, so we donated it to the Veneto, to the president of the Venetian community. And it's now sitting in Padua, and Daniel Liebskind is designing the base to support it. These are tombstones from the 1700s in St. Paul's Church graveyard. And they covered each one in a little tent so that the toxic and corrosive materials in the air, which we were all breathing in, wouldn't destroy the tombstones anymore. So They had their own little campground there. Yeah, so you could see in. Thoughtful, huh? One day, I mean, I probably did some really foolish things, but I was on my own. Luckily, I mean, had I gotten permission from the mayor, I would have had a cop in attendance with me, and I would have probably had 2 hours a day. But since it worked out in some other way, I had 10, 12, 14 hours a day, and I was on my own. And so I wandered around in caverns below ground and climbed up into buildings. And one day I climbed up into a dead escalator. I took it up and I wound up going through a plate glass window and I came into what was a play school. All the kids' jackets were still on the hooks and their little lunch boxes were lined up and you know all their work was around. But they had been yanked out when it happened. And so everything was as it was, except covered in this layer of dust. And it was odd to see this because this particular cluster of ambulance and cars almost looked like you were up at 20 stories looking down at the street. Something about it. This is about 6 months afterwards. It's amazing what lasts. But all around the periphery of the site, people wrote in the dust on the day that it happened. People wrote messages. I mean, first they identified things, morgue, triage, NYPD, fireman center. They had directions written in the dust. And then there were all kinds of slogans, both of affection and hate, and identifications, you know, so-and-so from the Steelworkers Union or whatever. And many of these things lasted well through the months of the work on the site. And I remember coming back to this and seeing this wall. The rain didn't wash it off. I mean, it just was as it was months later. Plumbers Local. They began to store a lot of the materials out in the landfill in Staten Island. It's called Fresh Kills. It was a landfill that was closed because it had gotten way out of proportion. And they reopened it for the deposit of all of this material. Well, on one of my visits out there, I found this Rodin sculpture lying on its side next to a piece of the fuselage from the airplane and some of the wheels from the airplane, just dumped there. One of the things I studied as I navigated the site over and over again was the way the shelters changed. On the first few weeks, the shelters were 2x4s and tarps. And then they became camping tents. And then they became slightly more serious tents. And then sort of wedding-like tents. And then they became little wooden structures. And then after that, they became slightly fancier with metal roofs and arched windows. I mean, the carpenters started to get creative. And the city on the fringes changed all the time. And it was so interesting to see this this evolution and how it went from raw to somewhat cultivated, in some sense of design. And in all these places, you were able to get fresh filters for your masks or bottled water and hot and cold drinks or get sweatshirts and gloves and boots and hats. And I mean, whatever you needed, it was there. There were places where you had therapists came, psychotherapists, physical therapists, acupuncturists, the works, you know. There were nursing stations, and there were whole floors in certain buildings that had been filled with Barca loungers and television sets so that the police and the firemen could go up there and rest in between shifts and sleep maybe for a couple of hours or watch a movie or go on the internet. I mean, a city, a support city was set up in the background. But first it looked like this. Nobody and no car or truck could leave the site without being hosed down or vacuumed down. All the trucks and cars were hosed down, top and bottom, because the mayor didn't want any fibers to get out into the... and firing it at the trucks. They called that the ghost train because it was the last train in the path station. Nobody was killed on it, but I mean, it was the one that was ready to go back to New Jersey underneath the river. And what you see here is a partial reveal of what they called the bathtub wall. This bathtub wall was on four sides, and it was seven stories deep, and it kept the Hudson River out. When they built the World Trade Center, all of the material that was in this hole was dumped on the other side of the hole, and it became landfill in the Hudson River, upon which they built those other buildings, the American Express building you saw, and a place they call Battery Park City, which is filled with apartments. So all of that was used as landfill. But the fear was that if this wall collapsed, the Hudson River would come in and flood Lower Manhattan. So that the miracle of the bathtub was that it didn't collapse. But I have to tell you, it was leaking like crazy. I mean, it was spouting. You'll see, I'll show you some images of it. I wanted to show this to you because there were 72 of these machines in that tiny area of four square blocks. 72 machines picking up steel all day long, day and night, and dumping it into dump trucks, of which there were 200. So the site, 24 hours a day, was filled with the noise of screeching metal as metal was being pulled apart from metal. All of the grinding, bumping sounds. And the site itself was made of that stuff, like a nest or a web of steel, and it wasn't solid at all. It shook all the time, not only from its fragile weaving, but it shook from the 72 machines that were pounding up and down on it all the time. Imagine how hard it was as a photographer to put a camera on a big camera on a tripod and try to breathe and wait for the moment when it all seemed to stop for a fraction of a second. To give you an idea of how much water was coming in, this is the bedrock. It was so wet that they had to pave the entire bedrock with these enormous timbers. They made a platform over the entire site so that all the cranes and the machinery could ride on that without sinking in the mud. Because it wasn't always schist underneath there, it was also more friable material. And water was constantly coming up. And to the architects in the room, I heard when I was there that in the South Tower there was a gigantic bilge pump that worked 24 hours a day because there was a source under the South Tower that was constantly, the river was constantly coming up into the basement. And for, I mean, nobody knows about this, but for the last 30 years, it was being pumped out every day, 24 hours a day. That's how fragile the footing was in some places there. So, these are the tracks of the path train. And all of these plugs you see in the wall are tiebacks. They would drill through the wall into the bedrock, some 70 feet down, and then they forced into it about 12 to 20 pieces of rebar, long, long rebar, and then some kind of epoxy. And then they twisted the rebar at a machine that twisted it into a braid, so it became one long twist inside. And then they forced concrete into it afterwards. And these plugs, as you could see, they're from 10 yards or less together, level after level. And they started on the at ground level because this wall moved forward. I was on the street the day that the wall moved, and the street opened up, this huge chasm, probably 3 feet across, but 3 feet across and straight down. The wall had fallen forward, so they started to tie back that wall. And then they did that practice all the way around the site. And you can see some of the drip marks, too, here and there. It was, for me, and I know from speaking to so many others down there, and for Daniel Liebskin, the architect whose vision was selected to make the to remake the World Trade Center, the enormity of the wall, the feeling of being down inside the pit, was the profound memorial image. And he wanted to keep that image. He wanted us to use the depth of this 72 feet or whatever it is as some way of connecting to the spirit of the place. But that's since been overruled. But you could get a sense of the mass of it. I mean, to me, it felt, each time I went down the ramp into it, it felt like I was going down into the pyramids in some way. There was a bigness to it and a raw power to it. Remember, these walls were buried. They were never meant to be seen again. They were behind the shiny facades of the mall down below, and they had marble plastered on them, and everything was covered up. And so to have it all ripped away, to have this rugged, coruscated wall visible again, was a powerful thing. And the image of the city above it was actually quite beautiful. Every time they found a body or a part, no matter what, they would stop work and they would make an honor guard and they would bring the remains up in a little casket with a flag over it. And this wasn't done for the press. There was no public showing of this. This was just because that's what it was. You found something and everybody stopped and gave it its required honor and respect. Very moving to see that. And you know, oftentimes down there it was folk imagery that came to the rescue, came to the emotional rescue. It wasn't always a bureaucratic decision. Some worker one day said, you know, it would be a great idea if we left one of these beams. This was one of the beams from the footprint, the outer edge of the footprint of the World Trade. Wouldn't it be a great idea if we left one of these up to the end and on the last day we cut it down, it will be the last body out? A worker said that. And the word got around, and suddenly the authorities said, yeah, what a good idea. Let's save one beam. So this was the designated beam. It was 62 tons, And you could see from the scale of this guy that it's five stories, something like that. I actually stood on top of that beam. I was put up on there by one of these cranes, lifted me up and put me on so I could photograph from up there. And this is in March. By the time they took it down at the end of May, the entire beam was covered in writing. People had managed to climb up it or paste pictures of, you know, the dead firemen on there, and people rode up on cranes, and they wrote their names all over it. It became this this icon, and it is now intact, out in JFK. This is at pretty much near the end of the work period, at the beginning of May. And in the middle, and in a few other places here, they created what they called raking fields, because they had gotten so far down, they had sifted through so much of the rubble, not only once here, but when all the rubble was sent out to fresh kills in Staten Island, it was sifted again, looking for everything. I mean, this was truly, every stone was turned in this case. And these raking fields, they would scrape up whatever was left down there, and they would dump it in the fields, and men and women would walk through and rake away and try to, you know, sift the last little bit of it. Every morning and every evening, they met in these two trailers, double-wide trailers, and the guy on the right with the white hard hat is named Charlie Vitchers. And he ran the site. He was the brain that commanded the site. And not an engineer, just a troubleshooting foreman for Bovis International, Bovis Lendlease. And those are the 50 different trades. And they would meet there. And this guy, Charlie, would stand up and say, off the top of his head, no clipboard, your team does this, your team does that, your team does this. And he had every single thing in his head every single day. He was a remarkable man. He was profane and funny and sharp. And I mean, he could have been the president of, you know, General Motors. That's how I felt. He was so together. And he had the absolute respect of all of these men. He was fair. An extraordinary character. He was the one who got me the beam, because when I went to ask for the beam, I went to all the authorities, and each one said, "Oh no, we can't do that. We can't give these things away." And you know, it was resistance everywhere. So I went to Charlie and I said, "Listen, you know, I'm going to the State Department. I'm going to represent the U.S. Pavilion. I would like to have a beam to bring over." He said, "Come with me." We went out, and there were hundreds of beams. He said, "You pick the one you want, and we'll take care of it." So I picked a few beams, and then he brought over one of these machines, and I wanted the beams turned over to see how they looked in different relations. And he had the guys turn the beams over and adjust them, turn them around, until I found the right one. Then he marked it up for me, and then he managed to get it shipped out of the site on a trailer to some container, and stuffed in a container and sent on its way to Italy. So it was good that I made friends with him. This is a father and son who lost the other son. The father's a retired fireman. They were there for 8 months, scraping away, looking for the remains of the brother. They never found him. And I got to know them pretty well. And this was toward the very end, and just they were standing there talking to somebody, and they, just the way they were standing, like two farm boys, you know, just leaning on the rake, something so humble about it. And he, the younger one, was known as the Raven. Everybody gets a nickname for something. He was called the Raven because he found more remains than anybody else. And I asked him one day, "Well, why? Why you?" He said, maybe I was looking for my brother so hard that I wanted, he said, I could differentiate between a pebble of concrete and a knuckle bone. He said, I would move these things around. He said, I would know the difference instantly. He said, there was something in the way it rolled or it fell. Something he studied, you know. But it's little things like that that brought a kind of humanity to the site every single day. And more than just one person. I mean, everybody contributed in profound and intimate ways to the heart, the big heart of this site. One day, one of these raking fields was just laid out. Usually a bulldozer would come and scrape it all up and then come back, and then the bulldozer would run backwards and jiggle its hod, and it would drop the leavings like that. And it was just that shift change, and there was nobody around. It was just the empty field. And I set up the camera, and I started to make a picture of this emptiness, just a dusty field, thinking it would be something interesting to look at in relation to people on it. And just then a man walked across the field. He was going home. And he picked up a rake that was lying in this area, and he raked his way out of the field. And I went over to him, and I talked to him, made a picture of him. And at some point I commented, I said how interesting it was to me that this age-old image of a person in a field raking. I mean, it's ancient. It's thousands of years old, this gesture. And I said how in a time of technology, this little handmade innocent act is the thing that is, you know, what it all comes down to. And he said, yeah, he said, I guess you're right. He said, that's us. We're just gardeners in the garden of the dead. And to hear somebody with that kind of connection, some kind of simple wisdom, was so moving to me. It stuck with me all this time. This is actually the last night, just a few minutes before we had a big ceremony. And there's still somebody on his hands and knees looking. On the night that is closing, you would think that people would just finish already. It's like he couldn't stop. This is the that one last stick that stood there. The most amazing thing happened. When it came down, workers came back by the thousands. People who hadn't been there for months came back for this event. The place was just filled down below. That entire pit was filled with people. And then they raised this thing up, and they brought in a flatbed truck. They called it the Black Virgin. It was an unused truck and unused flatbed and cab. They didn't want any truck that had been used before for anything. They wanted to put this beam on a brand new truck. And they lifted it up with these cables, they put it on the truck, and then they jumped all over it. Dozens of men wrapped a great big black nylon net around it, tucked it in at the edges and everything, hospital corners. I mean, really, they packaged this beam. And then they wrapped it in a flag and they put that on it. And it sat on the truck, and then the next day, after all the ceremonies and the speeches and the bagpipers, that truck went out as the last truck. And then they closed the site. And this is the last truck on the last moment of the site. And that's the last picture.
Photographs of this as it was happening, and I spent too much time on this. I wish I'd spent more time on that. That's my first question. My second question was your health affected by being there so much for so long?
I'll answer the second question first, but yes, what happened to the, here it is. Somewhat, at the beginning, I did wear a respirator, but it was a crappy little one you buy in the hardware store when you do sanding. And then I got a real respirator when more of them came, but you can't spend 12 hours in a respirator. It's disgusting. You know, you're breathing in your own breath over and over and over again, and you sweat in it. And so you have to take it off, and everybody down there did. And for a long while, I had a tickle. And I don't feel like I've ever quite regained the full strength of my voice since then. So yeah, in a minor way. I don't think I got as sick as some people I know got sick. Many of the guys in the arson explosion squad all had respiratory problems, every one of them. I did wish, I have to say, in some ways I think I failed. I mean, I know I made 8,500 pictures and I have saved something. But I knew in the beginning that it would take six of us. That would have been the right scale. And I modeled that idea on the Farm Security Administration photographs made during the Dust Bowl and the Depression. There was a unit that was made that probably more than a dozen photographers participated in. They made 250,000 photographs over those few years of the Depression to show what America looked like during that period, what the Dust Bowl looked like, and the impact on cities and small cities and farmers. I mean, it was an amazing story. And I thought six of us in this little area would have been able to fan out in a way that would allow us to have specialties and general pictures. And we would integrate it. It wasn't something I wanted to do alone. And so on days that I was down there, where I was busy with something and trying to free myself from there so I could go over there to do something, by the time I got there, it was gone. The site was moving. I mean, I can't tell you how many tons were going every single day. There's actually a figure on it. I should find that out. But it was in the thousands, the unknown thousands of tons were moving every single day. And so things would change in 24 hours. So I feel badly that I couldn't be everywhere at once, but I'm grateful for the time that I was able to put in and the coverage that I was able to do. And I didn't want it all for myself, frankly. Yes, somebody else. Yes, ma'am. I have a photograph of the day they found that cross and the guy who found it, a great big burly guy whose life was changed by finding that. Inside the customs house, thank you, inside the customs house, which was at the very edge of the site, the north tower fell and it went through the customs house and made an atrium that was about seven stories deep. And it sheared off all the floors. And it left that cross, or that image of the cross, there, standing, a freestanding cross. And this guy found it. And he was able to get a grappler to go in there and grab it and get it out. But before they got it out, this guy was so connected to it that he painted a path. Over the rubble, honest to God, he painted a path over the rubble with arrows all the way into this building to this viewing point where you could walk in and see this cross inside. That's how strongly he felt about it. And then they did get it out and they stuck it up on one of the piers for the bridge. There was a small footbridge that crossed over from the Winter Garden over to the upper level, the mezzanine level of the World Trade Center plaza. And that bridge collapsed, but the piers were left, and they planted this cross on top of that pier, right in the middle of the highway, basically. And then ultimately, they moved it around to the edge of the site, probably where you saw it. Yes? Interesting question. I was learning myself during that period how to take the right stance towards this work. I'm not a journalist, and I guess you could say every photographer is a documentarian to some extent. But I had never created an archive outside of myself. All my work is for me. And it's my own curiosity. But here I knew I was making something that I wanted to be useful. So I had to be practical, and I had to extend and expand my own awareness of what was interesting. I couldn't just keep it for myself, my own point of view. I had to try to think about the meaning of things, the potential reading of things. For example, a circuitous way of getting to your question, one day, I noticed, out of the corner of my eye, that many of the cabs of the flatbed trucks that were hauling stuff were painted with beautiful cartouche designs, the way trucks are often. And I thought, where are these coming from? These aren't just your ordinary trucks. And then I noticed they were coming from Indiana and Montana and Alabama and Louisiana. The people had come up with their rigs to participate. And these were rigs that they loved. They had made them. It's kind of folk art, isn't it? And so I began to photograph these things. Now, I'm not really interested in trucks. You know, truck design or motorcycle design is not my thing. But these trucks were personalities. They represented the people who committed themselves to making this this trip and doing this work. And so to represent them, I started adding trucks to my collection. So I probably have 60 truck pictures and portraits of all the drivers as well. So I was doing this in an ongoing way and feeling my way into trying to embrace the whole thing. I don't know. I mean, it's true. We're sitting here in an audience and you're seeing this image. In your eye, the picture is only 8 inches from that distance. I wanted them to be prints bigger than this screen, which they are, so that one's visceral connection when you stand in front of it is the way you link up with the image that's there, so that you could have free time to look all over the picture rather than to look at a work of art. In fact, I tried to efface myself. I thought it was imperative that this work be transparent so that you didn't look at the pictures and say, oh, that's a beautiful picture, that's well made, a made thing. That instead you would stand there and say, oh, I didn't realize that they had this much over there. I didn't know that this was made of this. Something of self-discovery in the image that wouldn't be directed by me in terms of a kind of showing you what to see, just sort of standing here, recognizing this thing, witnessing it, and then stepping aside photographically so that you could stand in my place and look at this in a fresh way. And that was the challenge for me. As this event recedes, we all are going to have a different relationship to it. And I wonder what it's going to be like for people who go to the Museum of the City of New York or the Library of Congress to look at all this work. I wonder how they're going to read it or interpret it later on. History works that way, doesn't it? Yes.
I'm one who thinks that pictures speak a thousand words. On the other hand, my response to the image changed from your pause after you gave a description or presented an anecdote. My response to the image changed to habit.
It did. Well, there's a book that's going to come out probably for the 5th anniversary, a really substantial book that's meant to work as a kind of library of images. And I am putting anecdotes with it. I mean, most of the time, most artists, me too, would rather you just look at the picture and not have to have any accompanying text with it to be explained. But this is the nature of this gathering. Is that there is an opportunity to share some of these memories and stories. And I think it adds to the power. I mean, I was there. I did go as the witness. I did volunteer to do not-for-profit work in this thing, to give this, because I saw that they had closed the site. And so this was a way of opening it to everybody else through me as your conduit. So in this case, I'm the voice also. And it's an interesting responsibility to have, because my memory of it has to be precise. I can't fictionalize this, you know? And so when I would come home on those evenings after spending 10 or 12 hours there, I often would sit with a tape recorder and just verbalize what was going on. There was a young woman in my studio who wanted to do radio documentary, even though she was working for me. And so she suggested to me that we do this. And she set up a tape recorder, and I'd come back, and I would just sit there, and I would talk into it and relate these things so that they stayed crisp and fresh and in the moment. Big responsibility, yeah.
It occurs to me, as you describe all of these repeated visits to this site, coming from my own discipline of sociology, that what you're doing in some sense is kind of photographic ethnography. You return to the site over and over and over, ostensibly with new questions about it on each trip. My question is, do you feel like you exhausted all of the questions you had about the site through this experience? Do you feel like you really understood it?
Did you hear the question? Good question. Well, there's a mixed answer to that. I did feel that I understood it. I had a feeling about it. I got to know it the way you walk a familiar path or you go for a hike over and over again to certain places because you like the feeling of it and you know the landmarks. And they're enriched for you each time you go. They're like old friends. So the site worked that way for me. But at the same time as I made the same path around and around, the site was diminishing and changing. It went from being 14 stories above ground to being 7 stories below ground in 8 months. So it was always different. The place was the same, but it was always different. I don't think I answered all the questions. There were places that I couldn't get into. There was experiences and emotions and observations I couldn't make because they were off limits, really off limits. So I sort of accepted the privilege that I did have. And I tried to stay with the awe of it, not to be jaded by it and say, yeah, I know this, I've seen this already, I don't have that. I try to stay open, and this is a really difficult task in an artist discipline, because we do become familiar with places or images or our responses. And so how does one stay engaged and try to penetrate your own resistance or your own knowledge to further open your capacity for understanding? I mean, it's a very interesting sort of discipline that one has to engage. And at the same time, fatigue does set in. I was carrying 20 some odd pounds of equipment. I had to walk 2 miles in every day and 2 miles back at night, 12 hours later. And during the day, I walked 6 or 8 miles around the site in Lower Manhattan. So I was doing somewhere like 10 miles a day, all by myself, carrying 25 pounds of equipment and trying to photograph. I ain't getting any younger. And it was about endurance as much as about staying open emotionally and intellectually and aesthetically. I mean, there were a lot of things that I never experienced before. My kind of photography is much more just floating through the world, and when I see things I'm interested in, I stop and I take them in and I connect to them if I can, and I try to understand them. But this was a kind of dogged work and a push against something that didn't yield easily. I mean, it wasn't easy on the eye. This didn't grace the eyeball the way landscape and light does. This was hard, sharp, nasty, dirty, you know. It was hard to look at. But I kept on thinking about making an interesting, readable text out of a photograph so that it was pliable. Somebody could sit in front of it and actually enter it, penetrate the surface. So that was a challenge. And I like that you say it was like a kind of ethnography, because I was dealing with all the levels that I could possibly understand as I was engaging them, which meant the personal level. I talked to 1,000 people. I mean it. I spoke to everybody down there, and they knew me. I was the old guy with the wooden camera, you know. Something about a wooden camera that's very useful in this situation. Everybody knows a digital camera, a video camera. They don't think 2 seconds about you. But an old mahogany wooden camera with a hood on it, somebody walking around and puzzling out things, people pay attention. And after a while, people would come over and say, "What are you doing? What's going on?" And to share this spiel with them, you know, "I'm making this record," they would then tell me something. They would give it to the record. So I was constantly enriched by their stories, by their adventures even, where they would like me to go, by things they gave me. I collected for the museum. More than the museum collected for the museum, I collected for the museum. I was not only carrying my equipment, I was carrying pockets full of stuff around at the end of the day. I mean, I have amazing things that I've, you know, given to the museum. So it was a loaded experience, and much more than I had bargained for when I began. Yeah, you were going to ask a question.
Are the tape recordings that you've already made going to be available in the museum? And do you have any plans to record at least several of the presentations that you're now making? I ask because I found your very articulate presentation of the images adding immeasurably to already immeasurably powerful photographs. And I would hate for whatever your voice communicates in terms of the authenticity of the experience, in terms of what you describe as the awe that you felt on a daily basis, to be lost in what ends up as text, captions, accompanying photographs. That's the first part of my response. The second is, it's very difficult for me, an architectural historian, to think of an architect, however brilliant, or a landscape architect, however brilliant, designing a memorial to that site that approaches in power the power of some of the photographs that you showed tonight. Maybe this is the wrong question to ask the author of the photographs, but I'm wondering if anybody has approached you in terms of providing these huge photographs that would be an integral part of whatever memorial is finally
Now imagine anything more powerful except perhaps for Leibniz's idea about exposing the 70-foot height of the story wall. That's the only thing in my mind that comes close.
Yeah, I agree with you about that. Certainly, I was privileged to be part of his team. And actually, his idea for these photographs was in the museum, the cultural space that he created with the escalator that goes down, originally was to go down to the site, he had anticipated in the hall all these photographs, or an assemblage of these photographs, as did Whitehead from the LMDC say that he wanted to have these photographs there. And nobody since then has talked about it because it's, I don't know who's designing that building yet. We said that Danny isn't going to design the buildings, as far as we know. He hasn't designed any of the buildings there. I think the powers that be know that the work is there. The Museum of the City of New York has many of these pictures already in this full size. So hopefully that will be there as some commemorative view of what the site looked like in the process of transition. I've been, just like tonight, he's tape recorded me doing this. And I would request a copy of this because I give the Museum of the City of New York all of these records as part of the verbal, the oral history of it. But it's true, text and the spoken word are two different things. And I don't know what to do about that. I have thought about making a film, still and moving film, because I actually shot video down there too. Not heavily enough, because it was one more thing to carry by myself. And I already had three cameras when I was down there. I had a Leica, I had a middle format camera, and I had my view camera. So a movie camera was yet another clunker on me. But I have the entire 8 months. And I thought maybe I would make, at some point soon, sort of a Ken Burns-like document in a series of four sections, let's say, an hour each, that would share a lot of this, because there are many other images that I can't show here. I mean, I showed you only 59 or 60 images, you know, out of 8,000. And there are a lot of other startling things, and there's a chronology too. It goes, you know, thoroughly describing each period. So I have to get some funding for it and do it. I did this entire thing without funding. It crippled me financially to do this work because the Museum of the City of New York had no organization whatsoever and they raised no money. And so I was out on a limb for this entire project, which was over $600,000. In terms of time and people, I had seven people working in my studio, where prior to that I had 1.5 people, you know, for a few days a week. Suddenly I had seven people full time to back me up so that I could be down there doing that work. Scanners and printers and, you know, managers and all of that. And I wound up footing the bill for the whole thing, which ultimately cost me my apartment in New York. I had to sell my apartment to help keep the thing going. Life throws a funny twist at you sometimes. You try. The museum director said to me over and over again, no good deed goes unpunished. Over and over he said that to me, as if I would feel better. I said, just raise some money, I'll feel a lot better. Yeah.
You know, it's kind of a related question. When I heard the presentation, when you show an image, particularly when there weren't people in it, the image to me looked rather dispassionate. Then there was a pause, and then you would talk about the thing, and all of a sudden it seemed very compassionate. And it was an interesting sort of counterpointing of a relatively dispassionate image and then a compassionate presentation of it. And it made me wonder about how this may or may not have affected your work afterwards. You know, were you one type of a photographer before having this 8-month encounter, and a different type of photographer now?
Well posed. I am different. I certainly am different. And I feel like I have a different mission. Before, at periods of my life, I've been shooting 42 years. So I've gone through a lot of changes. But there have been vast periods where I was in dialogue or argument with photography itself. How does photography work? Why color? You know, how do you make this a more sensitive and expressive medium? There's a lot of things that one could argue about the art form itself. And I sort of segued away from social concerns to personal concerns or art world concerns. And now I feel at my age and after this experience that every year I should try to do something of social value. And I should work on larger scale projects for the public good. I'm just about to begin one in New York. I was invited by the Commissioner of Parks. That same guy who got me the pass was the head of Manhattan's Parks. He's now the Commissioner of the Parks. And he came to me just a few months ago and said, we've got 27,000 acres of parks in New York that no one knows anything about. Not Central Park and Prospect Park, but all the other parks. He said there's 50 or 60 of them that are wilderness parks in the city, and they encroach on or cohabit the space with communities. And we want to show that these parks are active and part of it. And would you like to spend a year in the parks and photograph all of these parks and make something that shows how important parks are to urban spaces? Anyway, I've taken it on, and we're now at the point where we're looking for a sponsor to fund this, because I'm not going to do this one like I did the last one. I don't have anything else to sell. And you know, it's a budget. It's a budget of $800,000 to spend a year and to do all of this work and to produce it in the studio and to run this. So now we have to do that. But I feel like these things have come to me now because I want to be more useful instead of just be, you know, an artist fighting with the structure of art or the meaning of art. So I have changed, yeah. And maybe even my approach has changed, more open-hearted, I think. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
If you want to talk with him, he's welcome to do that too.
Sure.